It being 5:42, the House will now proceed to the consideration of private members' business as listed on today's order paper.
What did you gain by that?
Private members' business resuming consideration. Private members' business resuming consideration at second reading of Bill C-223, National Framework for a Guaranteed Livable Basic Income, standing in the name of Ms. Gazan.
It's under my control. You can't expect us to say yes to something.
Yes. Order. I'm trying to get the House procedure continuing, and it's very difficult to do that when the clerk's trying to read what we are going to be debating and when individuals are trying to have a debate across each other, across the floor. And so we are now resuming debate. Reprise de débat, the honourable member for Winnipeg South Centre.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. It's always a pleasure for me to rise in this House on behalf of those I represent in Winnipeg South Centre. Madam Speaker, I want to thank my colleague across the way from Winnipeg Centre, who is also a neighbour of mine. Our constituencies border one another. And I know that the member for Winnipeg Centre comes to work every day, Madam Speaker, with a genuine desire to advocate for those that she serves. And in many instances, Madam Speaker, those that she serves are amongst the most impoverished in our city and in our country. During my years, Madam Speaker, as an educator, as a teacher and a principal in particular, I learned a lot about the various things that are required for kids and their families to live a successful and healthy life. In particular, Madam Speaker, I can recall a program in the Seven Oaks School Division, of which I was an employee, located in the northwest part of the city of Winnipeg for a number of years, that sought to give families and their kids a leg up. And what we did at that time is we took some grant money that had been given to us through a partnership at the province, and we provided those in need, usually it was single mothers with kids at home living in some precarious situations by virtue of poverty, intergenerational trauma, and other obstacles that daily life presents, and we gave them cash on a monthly basis. And what they did with that money is they invested it in the basic necessities of life, which included food, books, transportation, and other things that would make life easier, healthier, and more comfortable for them and their children. On that note, Madam Speaker, I do want to say that I'm extremely proud of the investments that the federal government is making in a national school food program. I understand that there are some significant conversations happening and progress is underway with my home province of Manitoba, where a collaboration between our two levels of government is going to leverage existing funding to help make sure that kids in need in our province are getting the type of nutritious and healthy food that they need to succeed. And what we saw, Madam Speaker, going back to this program in my former school division, was that people were happier, they were healthier, and they had that boost and that leg up that they needed. Now, Madam Speaker, in my home province of Manitoba, in the 1970s, there was an experiment. It was in the city of Dauphin in northern Manitoba. And it was undertaken and constructed, implemented by a woman named Dr. Evelyn Forget. And I'm very proud to say, Madam Speaker, that Dr. Forget is a constituent of mine. And I remember during my by-election just last year when I knocked on her door and we started talking about basic minimum income, she said, "I really think you ought to be thinking about this," and gave me some ideas. And I said, "Did you know that there was a project in Dauphin in the 1970s? And she said, "Yes, I wrote it." So it was fascinating for me to have the opportunity to have a constituent with such a high degree of expertise and firsthand knowledge of this important issue. And since then, I've had some very interesting conversations with Madame Forget and with other members of my constituency who have articulated their desire to see me support this piece of legislation put forward by my colleague from Winnipeg Centre. What's interesting when you read about the program in Dauphin in the 1970s and you look at some similar implementation of programs as recently as a few months ago here in the province of Ontario, you see emerging some very interesting stories that paint a picture of the ways in which a form of a basic minimum income could be of benefit to Canadians. So, Madam Speaker, at this stage of the debate, which is one that would, if the bill is able to pass through this stage and then lend itself to further discussion at the committee, is one that is worthy of our support. I believe that it is merited for us to have a longer conversation about this piece of legislation, and I think it's appropriate in our system, in our parliamentary system, that the committee stage, whereby we hear from witnesses and experts who give us guidance on whether or not it makes sense for us to move forward, is an appropriate place for this particular piece of legislation to further explore the merits or the disadvantages of a basic minimum income. So with that, Madam Speaker, I would like to let the House know that I will be, when the time comes to vote on this particular piece of legislation, lending my support to it. I will note, Madam Speaker, that I do have questions and I do have concerns, particularly as they pertain to cost, fairness, and distribution. However, as I noted a moment ago, Madam Speaker, I trust that a thorough review of the proposed policies that we have seen listed in this piece of legislation at the committee stage will help us to answer those questions and let members decide at that point whether or not the merits of such legislation deserve to go on to the next stage. So with that, Madam Speaker, I'm going to keep my remarks more brief today than perhaps I would otherwise, and I will conclude by again reiterating that I thank my colleague and my neighbour in Winnipeg for putting forward this piece of legislation, for enabling us to have an important discussion in this place about how we can support one another. And I will look forward to following the remarks that are to come from other colleagues as we decide whether or not to allow the legislation to advance to the next stage. Thank you very much, Madam Speaker.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Member for Calgary Shepherd.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. So it's always a great privilege to rise in the House to speak on behalf of the residents of Calgary Shepherd, who over the past basically 2 years have written to me on multiple occasions, both for and against universal basic income, and specifically on this legislation as well as what I'll call its partner legislation that is in the Senate as well, which very confusingly has almost the same numbers, so sometimes people get them confused with other bills, and it's very difficult to understand when they send you in the subject line this particular bill, but they don't explain S or C, and then you're trying to figure out, are they talking about certain legislation or others? So I'm always looking to respond to them, but sometimes I get it wrong. Then we have a conversation back and forth. I have taken the time to read the legislation over, so I want to give the member who sponsored the legislation the benefit of going through each section on the merits of the content. Now, I will be voting against it, and so I want to explain section by section why that is. So section one is the development, so it says the national framework. This is the part where a lot of constituents have told me that they have concerns about. There are those who support it too, but on the balance of the issue, they want me to vote against it. This would create a national framework for the implementation of a guaranteed livable basic income program throughout Canada for any person over the age of 17, and then goes into including temporary workers, permanent residents, and refugee claimants. Now, this doesn't say successful claimants. It doesn't have the classification of protected persons. It doesn't refer to international students. It uses the wording temporary workers, which could mean a series of different things when you read it over. The bill also doesn't have a royal recommendation. The bill doesn't seek to spend any money. So when I was responding to constituents, I noted that for them. This bill doesn't have a budget assigned to it, doesn't have an amount assigned to it. And so that is one of the reasons I would vote against it right away, because it's creating a framework legislation. I generally don't support framework legislations. I have on a few occasions when I thought it wouldn't be an imposition of huge new costs. Section 2 has a consultation provision. Generally, I like these types of consultation requirements, both with provincial governments, territorial governments, indigenous governments as well. I think it's more than reasonable. I come from the province of Alberta, where there's a requirement on the provincial government, especially, for example, with Métis settlement general councils, which I think so far we are the only provincial government where it's a requirement. You actually cannot change the legislation affecting MSGCs without their consent, which I think is one of the first, if I'm not wrong, in amongst provincial governments. I think it's a good idea, generally. Now onto the content, which is Section 3. It says that the framework must include 4 different types of provisions in it. For example, just to give you an example, Madam Speaker, a guaranteed livable basic income program doesn't result in a decrease in services or benefits meant to meet an individual's exceptional needs related to health or disability. But of course, then that would make it not universal. In my view, would be equal treatment for all, exactly the same. And in reading the economic magazines on the subject and journals on the subject, of which I'll refer to in a moment, they specifically state that a UBI or a negative income tax, which famously is kind of where the idea comes from, it has to be completely equal to every single person, regardless of their starting point. There's information in here ensuring participation, education, training, or the labor market is not required in order to qualify for a guaranteed livable basic income, which then I would have questions then about temporary workers being made eligible for something like this. And international students, like I said, are not mentioned, but international students as of September 1st of this year can continue to work 24 hours in our labor market. But if their non-participation would allow them to participate in this, except they're specifically excluded in Section 1, I just wonder whether that was intentional or not. I don't know. There's a second section here that create national standards for health and social supports that complement a guaranteed basic income program and guide the implementation of such a program in every province. So I have 2 major concerns. Provincial jurisdiction. This is an encroachment into a provincial jurisdiction. My province gets to set what programs it wants. It doesn't have to in any way submit to the federal government when it's purely with its own provincial jurisdiction. That's one. Setting national standards encroaches on provincial jurisdiction. I'm sorry, on healthcare, social supports. My province has an age and PDD programs, many others, and it's an encroachment to set a national standard, even if you consult with them. Consultation doesn't always lead to agreements, and our constitution is very clear that there are areas of exclusive jurisdiction. I know that's a comment often made by Quebec members of parliament from different political parties, but it's one I think a lot of us Albertans make as well, is we have exclusive jurisdiction in many areas and we want the federal government to stay out of them. The A component here again talks about what would constitute a living basic income in each region of Canada without spelling out what region would mean. In the Constitution of Canada, regions is actually separated into 4 if you use the Senate rules, and it has Western Canada, Ontario, Quebec, and Atlantic Canada, which hopefully that's not what region means in this sense, because I think our state has evolved quite significantly, where now the province of Alberta and the province of British Columbia combined together have a bigger population than the province of Quebec. If I go on here, there's a framework that's required to be tabled. And there's more information on when it must be tabled, when must the report be provided to the House. So I have a Yiddish proverb, Madam Speaker, as I always do. I did forget to give one when I started speaking on C-71, which I will always admonish myself for doing so. So it says, he who is aware of his folly is wise. And I think in this instance, it's one of those situations where in the moment that we are in, let's look at what's going on so we don't do something rash with our finances. We're facing a $40 billion deficit. And I wonder how will we pay for this? And Jim Seeley in my riding was actually the one that wrote this great email just asking a lot of questions about costs, percentages, who'd be eligible, how would CPP work, how would old age security work, just questions and questions and questions that he was wondering about. And I had to tell him, I'm not quite sure. I did go and look, though, at the government's projections for future years. When does it expect to have a surplus? And then from a surplus, presumably, you would be looking then at, you know, could you do a universal basic income? Could you do a negative income tax? There's a $20 billion deficit in the last financial year that's forecast. The government of Canada expects to accumulate a deficit of $157 billion by fiscal year 2028-2029. $157 billion, Madam Speaker. That's without any new spending announcements. That means no new public infrastructure dollars added on top of what's already been announced. That means no new procurement. That means nothing new, nothing extra above and beyond that. And they would still run a $20 billion deficit. So how would this all be paid for is what I wonder. And finally, like I mentioned, the negative income tax, this has been something that's been talked about for at least the last 50 to 60 years. It was first produced by the Nobel Prize-winning economist Milton Friedman, oftentimes tagged as an economist of the right. I don't think that's entirely fair to him. I think on UBI, NIT, whichever acronym you want to use, and they work in a slightly different way, but their goal is sort of the same. He recognized that a lot of public advocates on the left generally were very enthusiastic about the ideas he explained, especially the mechanisms it would work on and its end goal. And those public advocates on the right said that they were much less enthusiastic and actually heavily criticized him at the time that he wrote the journal. So he recollected about this quite often. There's a great YouTube video I send to constituents quite often for them to hear from the expert and from him basically on the logic of how it would work. But one of the things about UBI or NIT that he talked about, so these are his thoughts on the subject, is that you would have no other welfare programs competing at the same time, and you would have much less of he called civil servants, he called them nannies, that would look over the spending of citizens, of how they were living their lives and what they were doing. So I really hope, when I'm a speaker, just back to my Yiddish proverb, that we would be careful with the public's finances. We see it reflected in the polls, but I heard it at the doors while I was door knocking in my riding of Calgary Shepherd. My constituents are worried about the public finances. They're worried about a $40 billion deficit. They're worried about $150 billion of more debt being accumulated onto the credit card of the nation. That's why I'll be voting against this piece of legislation. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Abitibi, Bay James Nunavik, EU. Madam Speaker, I'm pleased to give my first speech since returning from the summer recess. Before talking about Bill C-223, I would like to take advantage of my time to say hello to the people of Abitibi, Bay James Nunavik, EU. Throughout the summer, I travelled thousands of kilometres to meet the people of the riding, visiting organisations and companies, and taking part in galas and festivals. I went to meet groups of seniors to discuss the two classes of seniors created by the government with regards to pensions. What amazing encounters. I'd like to warmly thank all those who came to see me or who met me. Thanks to them, I've come back to Ottawa fully energised with lots of projects and challenges to tackle. I'm back in Ottawa full of their requests, concerns and issues. Let us come back to Bill C-223, Madam Speaker. As we've heard earlier, this bill requires the Minister for Finance to develop a national framework to provide access to an adequate basic income guarantee for everyone over the age of 17 in Canada. It also requires the Minister to report on the framework. We need to start by asking ourselves what the concept of a guaranteed basic income is. According to the Library of Parliament's legislative summary for Bill S-233, a basic income guarantee is a transfer of money from the government to individuals or families to provide them with a basic income below which they cannot fall. You know, Madam Speaker, this summer I heard a lot of good stories from my fellow constituents, but I've also heard some not so good ones. These are very difficult times. Everything is more expensive and many people simply can't cope anymore. Some have reached the point where they have to choose between buying their medicine, paying their insurance, or eating properly. For example, there's a mother of a 3-month-old baby who chose to feed her child tinned ravioli because it's cheaper. Some elderly people feed themselves cat food to save money and to be able to buy their medicines. I met workers who can no longer afford accommodation, have to sleep on their family or friends' sofas or live in their cars. So the intention of this bill is noble, Madam Speaker. But unfortunately, this is another centralizing bill that flouts the jurisdictions of Quebec, the other Canadian provinces, and the territories. What is more, it does not take into account Quebec's particularities and the particularities and characteristics of other Canadian provinces and territories. As you know, Madam Speaker, the provinces and territories are responsible for administering their own social programs. To pass a bill like C-223 would be to ignore the jurisdictions of Quebec and the other provinces and territories and to hand them over directly to a central government known to be particularly inefficient. Quebec could implement such a measure of its own accord, as could the other Canadian provinces and territories. The adoption and implementation of such a colossal federal measure in parallel with the Quebec government's management of its many programs would be a nightmare, Madam Speaker. Let us be honest. The Canadian government does not have the means to introduce such a measure in the current economic context where inflation is still present, historical deficits are increasing the public debt, and the Liberals have no plan to balance the budget. The Liberal government is already unable to honour its agreements on the transfer for health and housing and many other areas. How can we trust a government that takes money from Quebec taxpayers and then blackmails them and imposes conditions in order to just get a fraction of it? We know the federal government's contempt when it comes to assuming its responsibilities. We know that it is very difficult to get paid adequately. Federal transfers are too often insufficient or non-existent. During this parliament, we've seen just how difficult it is for this centralizing government to restore fiscal balance and how it hogs far too much money to spend, generally for electoral purposes and rarely for the benefit of Quebecers. The adoption of C-223 would have the effect of breaking up Quebec's social safety net and all the social services offered to Canadians. Quebec's tax system would be hit too hard, and the entire administration of the Quebec state would have to be recalibrated. The premise of Bill C-223 is that a measure like the Universal Guaranteed Minimum Income will have a positive impact on wealth disparities and poverty, but experts are very divided on the issue. I will give you an example, Madam Speaker, commissioned in 2018 by British Columbia, which was considering the idea of such a measure. The report by a panel of university experts concluded that a basic guaranteed income was not the best way to help the poorest people out of poverty. Instead, the panel recommended specific government support combined with existing social programs. According to their estimates, updating existing programs and creating specific assistance would have cost British Columbia taxpayers between $3.5 and $5 billion. On the other hand, the introduction of a guaranteed minimum for everyone would have cost nearly $52 billion. In no way does this bill or the people who defend this concept take into account the enormous cost to the provinces that would be forced to completely rethink the management of their social programs. Madam Speaker, the Parliamentary Budget Officer put a cost of such a measure at nearly $98 billion at the national level over 6 months alone. The experience in British Columbia reinforces the position of the Bloc Québécois and the Quebec government to target aid to citizens. You may not be aware of this, Madam Speaker, but in 2017, a committee of experts commissioned by the province of Quebec concluded that overall Quebecers benefited from an income support system that provided significant assistance covering the main stages of life during which a Quebecer might find himself or herself in a vulnerable situation. Their survey report emphasized that, taken as a whole, the existing income support system in Quebec is partly consistent with the definition of a guaranteed minimum income. In short, the introduction of a guaranteed minimum income would have a colossal impact that would require a substantial increase in taxes or the discontinuation of many existing programs, thereby creating serious instability that bureaucratic structures and technological tools would simply not be able to keep pace with. In the future, it will be up to Quebecers to choose whether they want a program like this or to maintain existing programs. It is definitely not up to Ottawa to dictate how our social programs are managed. What's more, we have no guarantee that this method, while attractive on paper, will be effective and achieve its objectives. It is also a question of fairness. Quebec has chosen to create social programs for services in health, education, affordable childcare, parental leave, car insurance, preventative withdrawal, etc., etc., etc. These programs are designed to ensure that everyone has access to the same services. Moreover, Quebec's social programs are performing well, as it has one of the lowest levels of wealth inequality, along with Prince Edward Island and New Brunswick. If ever the government really had the money to fund such a program that encroaches upon provincial jurisdictions, I suggest it instead take that money to help people aged 65 to 74 who have been excluded from the old age pension increase. The government could take this money to honour its commitments on transfers to the provinces and territories. It could also build more housing and infrastructure. It could also pay its share of the costs incurred for asylum seekers in Quebec. I'm sure that the government could find ways to use this money in its areas of jurisdiction without encroaching upon provincial and territorial jurisdictions, as it so likes to do. The proof. The severity of the intrusions into the jurisdictions of Quebec, the other provinces and the territories this government set out in the 2024 budget is historic, and Ottawa has never gone so far in its centralization of powers. I understand the good intentions behind the tabling of this bill, but I repeat, it is up to the provinces and territories to put in place a framework providing access to an adequate basic guaranteed income, not the federal government. As you can see, Madam Speaker, for these reasons, we will not be supporting Bill C-223. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Bravo. Resuming debate, the Honourable Member of Portmoday Coquitlam.
Madam Speaker, the wealth in this country is disproportionately held by rich CEOs and their companies. And that hoarding of wealth is hurting women, Indigenous people, persons with disabilities, and all people without the power or access to fight corporate greed. Canadians live in one of the richest countries in the world, yet many Canadians are grappling with the weight of poverty and financial insecurity at the expense of corporate greed. Canadians deserve a government that gives them the relief they need, not more handouts for rich CEOs and tax breaks for corporations. The inequality in society is stark. The cost of food is increased by over 20%, and we know that 1 in 5 Canadians are skipping meals. As we navigate this shifting landscape, people across Canada, especially those suffering the most due to systemic inequalities, are feeling the effects even more. It doesn't have to be this way. Poverty is one of the most avoidable, violent human rights violations in this country. Poverty is a violation of the Canadian Charter, and Canada can end poverty with this important bill. A bill for a framework for a guaranteed livable basic income brought by my colleague, the NDP member from Winnipeg Centre. The NDP respects Canadians' charter rights. The Conservatives, though, have already said they don't respect the Charter and are open to bypassing it at will by using the notwithstanding clause and are not supportive of this bill to end poverty. Basic necessities like food, housing, and health care are not just becoming more expensive. They're becoming less accessible. This crisis is hitting marginalized people hardest. Women and disproportionately racialized women are affected by rising costs and stagnant wages. They are the backbone of our communities and our economy, yet they are struggling to make ends meet. This is wrong. Under the Liberals' watch, we have seen basic necessities grow increasingly out of reach. We know the grocery sector is making record profits and in 2023 raked in $6 billion. This is unconscionable when families are struggling to feed their children and workers across this country have to choose between rent and food. Seniors are skipping meals to afford their medications, and women who already face systemic barriers in the workplace are now forced to take on multiple jobs just to keep their bills paid. While the government made lofty promises, the reality on the ground is telling a very different story. The rising cost of living is not just an economic statistic, it's a daily struggle for countless Canadians. Meanwhile, Conservatives want to cut spending on public services that support the most in need. They want to cut essential services like childcare, and I'm hearing a beautiful child tonight in the chamber, which would force women disproportionately out of the workforce to care for their families, as well as healthcare and pharmacare they want to cut, which would only exacerbate cost of living challenges. The Conservatives, without a doubt, will put more Canadians into poverty. At a time when we are seeing record amounts of homelessness, with wages continuing to stagnate because of a government after government's choices to choose corporations over Canadians, we need to give back hope. We need Canadians to know that with a new government, things can get better, not cut important supports people rely on. This isn't just a matter of politics. It's a matter of basic human dignity. Canadians deserve better. Our communities deserve better. That's why we in the NDP are fighting for solutions that truly provide relief for Canadians. A guaranteed livable basic income would transform the lives of all Canadians. This is a transformative policy that would ensure every Canadian has the financial support necessary to live with dignity and security. Imagine a Canada where no one has to worry about where their next meal will come from or whether they can afford to keep a roof over their head. A guaranteed livable basic income would be a crucial step towards alleviating the economic struggles faced by so many, including Indigenous peoples, persons with disabilities, women, and all marginalized communities. We heard in committee that children across this country are going to school hungry, and there is a wide array of intersectional issues that a guaranteed livable basic income will address for them. It would also empower individuals to pursue additional education without fear of massive debt. Workers could seek additional training without risking their livelihoods, and people could seek better work opportunities without the constant fear of financial losses. And for people who cannot work in this ableist society, they will have dignity too. The positive impact of a GLBI on people with disabilities cannot be understated. For many individuals living with disabilities, the current system is fraught with challenges, barriers to employment, limited access to services, and a safety net that the Conservatives and the Liberals continue to wear away at. Current estimates say that 1.5 million Canadians living with disabilities live below the poverty line, and close to a million of those are working-aged people. A guaranteed livable basic income would provide the support needed for people living with disabilities. It would also help Canada meet its commitment under Section 8 of the UN-CRPD, Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, as well as constitutional commitments to ensure the provisions of essential public services of reasonable quality to all Canadians, something that the government is not doing right now, Madam Speaker. The promise of a GLBI is not just theoretical. It is a realistic solution that has been successfully implemented in various forms around the world, and trials here in Canada have shown that when people are given a financial safety net, they thrive. The NDP understands that a guaranteed livable basic income is not just a policy, it's a commitment to building a more equitable society. And the NDP would like to see this bill go to committee as soon as possible to hear from all of the communities that support a guaranteed livable basic income.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Environment and Climate Change and to the Minister of Sport and Physical Activity.
Thank you, Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. It's an honor and a privilege to stand in this House today after a summer break for the first time and speak to a policy proposal from the New Democratic Party on something that I've always been very interested in looking at and studying. I'm always enthusiastic about any policy that's proposed in this House that aims to reduce or eliminate poverty in Canada, and this project to bring forward a universal basic income is one that I'm keenly interested in. And immediately it caused me to look back on Ontario's efforts over the last decade or so to implement something similar here in the province of Ontario, and very close to my home. In fact, I grew up at the Chautauqua Co-op in Oakville, and the Wynne government, the Liberal Wynne government in Ontario in 2017 brought forward a pilot project, which was to provide a basic income to 4,000 people across Ontario. And that project followed recommendations made by Hugh Siegel in consultation with lots of various groups, Madam Speaker. It was a good start. You know, basic income would reduce poverty more effectively, and it could encourage work, reduce stigmatization, but more than that, it also reduces a lot of the bureaucracy involved in the navigation of all of these various programs. You know, I remember, or actually just a couple weeks ago, instead of using an old example, I'll use a recent one. Just a couple of weeks ago, had a gentleman in my office in Milton to discuss all of the confusion related to interim unemployment, related to his tenuous employment. And, you know, he was navigating both the Ontario Disability Support Program, Ontario Works, and employment insurance all at the same time. And with other benefits from this government, like Canada Child Benefit and many others, there are, you know, it's a constellation of support programs which aim to reduce poverty in Canada. It's a lot of administration, it's a lot of programs, and you know, when you cater all of these programs to various groups and various people, they're good because they can be very, very targeted, but at the same time, it requires, you know, sometimes a master's in public policy in order to figure out how to maximize those benefits that, you know, we all pay for. I think about employment insurance often. You know, people are often very reluctant to go on employment insurance in Ontario. I have a friend who just got laid off and said, well, I don't want to go on EI. And I said, why? That's the insurance that you've been paying into with every single paycheck since you were 16 or 17 years old. You deserve that money. The reason that you paid into that program is because you want to make sure that you have that stability necessary. And that stability will could also be provided by a universal basic income as proposed by this bill. Unfortunately, Madam Speaker, 10 months after the Liberal administration of this project in I believe it was in Thunder Bay and in Hamilton, Ontario, and a couple of other smaller municipalities. Doug Ford and his progressive conservative government, after saying they would allow the completion of the program so that they could fully study it, they canceled it. They canceled it very, very abruptly and left these 4,000 participants in this pilot project in the lurch and devastated, quite frankly. So, you know, for better or for worse, the Premier of Ontario has demonstrated the ability to change his mind quite often. Sometimes that's been good when he decided not to pave the Greenbelt. You know, and other times like this, he went back on his word and canceled a program which he said was worth completing. It was worth completing, and this is worth studying, Madam Speaker. You know, all the anti-poverty groups that I've ever met with and continue to read about are in favor of universal basic income, and it's sort of sad to hear conservatives talk about poverty elimination as a left-wing concept. I don't think poverty elimination is a left-wing concept. I think it's for everybody in this House. I think we should all be concerned with how legislation encourages poverty, creates poverty, and sustains poverty in Canada. There's absolutely no reason for a wealthy a country like Canada to have anybody in deep poverty, and I strongly believe that a universal basic income is one thing that's worth studying so that we can look into all the various ways to ensure that we're doing the most for Canadians, whether they're employed, between employment, unable to find employment, or, frankly, taking risks. You know, conservatives like to talk about how it's important out there in the real world, despite, you know, their leader never having really ever ventured there. to be able to take risks financially. And, you know, if you want to innovate, if you want to do art, if you want to practice something new, that might take some time. And I love the idea that the universal basic income or a guaranteed livable income would provide people with the ability to take those risks, innovate, try something new, create art, maybe even try out for a new team or something like that, showing my stripes as an athlete. So I applaud the member from the New Democratic Party for their work on this, and I'm looking forward to hearing more throughout the debate. I would cede the rest of my time to the New Democrats. Thanks.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Member Central, Okanagan, Similkameen, Nicola.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and as always, it's an honour to rise on behalf of the good people of Central Okanagan, Similkameen, Nicola, and to speak on a topic that I know that there are a range of views, and in a democracy we can disagree, but I would say everyone who's spoken tonight obviously believes that Canadians, particularly those living in poverty, I spoke earlier today in a statement about how being part of being Canadian is to try and help one another. So I think many of the sentiments is good. It's just how best to achieve that. And so while I certainly will take issue with elements that are presented here tonight, I do want to acknowledge that the member has submitted an idea for debate that she feels very strongly on and deserves credit for having brought the issue to the forefront. Madam Speaker, Bill C-223, an act to develop a national framework for a guaranteed livable basic income. First of all, I think it's important to say what this particular piece of legislation would do. It would not actually enact a guaranteed livable basic income. It is more of a discussion, a framework to have further discussions so that at some point there could be some sort of report that's done by the minister after discussing such a framework with and doing subsequent work to it. Now, let's just start with this first. There's lots of discussion. Milton Friedman, famous American economist, some would argue one of the greatest economists of all times, talked about a reverse income tax that would be able to pay people for along the same types of things. So this is not something that is just found in left-wing politics. Some people have mentioned former Senator Siegel, who has a long career in Kenny. So this is an area that has advocates both on the left of the political spectrum as well as the right. What I would say, Madam Speaker, more than anything else today is two things. First of all, I'm speaking personally. I follow what political philosopher Karl Popper used to discuss, the use of something called reverse utilitarianism. So you may recall, Madam Speaker, that utilitarianism is usually public policy that is meant to do the most good for the most people and to increase the general happiness for the most people. Reverse utilitarianism is actually to reduce the suffering of those that suffer the most. So anytime we have this question about universal programs, we have to say who would be receiving said programs. And universal programs are not cheap, Madam Speaker. That means that every single person, regardless of their condition, would have at their ability just by choosing to opt into this framework of to receive money from the federal government would have that choice. But we don't talk about the people, Madam Speaker, persons with disabilities, those that have the toughest situation. We're actually, by giving money to those that are able, we actually take away resources that could go towards helping those that have the most severe issues so that they can live a fulfilling life within society. And I think that's something we always best keep in mind. In fact, when the BC NDP government established a panel that did a report in 2020, this is one of their key concerns, Madam Speaker, is that by simply giving out money, it doesn't necessarily mean that those who need it the most get the exact support they need. This has been brought up, the cost of it has been brought up. Again, speaking to University of British Columbia, economist Kevin Milligan, he's argued that a universal basic income, whatever name you use, would be enormously expensive. And that's something actually the panel did say in its report. And again, it did talk about the need to have some of these discussions. Now, I would say, Madam Speaker, this, if we were, at post-World War II parliamentarians discussing, okay, Germany and other countries are putting in a welfare state. Should we consider doing likewise, perhaps having a discussion with a young and with a tremendous amount of economic growth, a young population with economic growth would certainly be able to support such a policy. And we would have a legitimate choice between apples and oranges, the apples of the welfare state or the orange here of a universal basic income. But Madam Speaker, we are not in a position where we have, the economic, our economic growth is not flowing. We have something called secular stagnation. And the indebtedness of not just of G7 and G20 countries, but the aging populations, Madam Speaker. We already see that we have many provinces where businesses are complaining about the lack of workers. Now, there is some we've seen unemployment tick up, but Madam Speaker, at a time where we are saying that we need to have more people to build the homes, why would we be inducing healthy individuals to take a benefit from the government and just take them out of the workforce completely? So, Madam Speaker, I understand the sentiment behind the thinking here that the member is choosing, but I don't think this is the right policy environment for this type of policy to go forward. Again, our aging demographics, we want to encourage more people to work. Why, Madam Speaker? Well, because our old age security system, something that I think most people, if you talk to most Canadians, they feel it's a pillar that's important to support. It is, again, a transfer from existing taxpayers today, those that are paying taxes, send it to Ottawa in good faith, and then those transfers go out to what's becoming a larger and larger population of seniors. So, Madam Speaker, suddenly switching the gears and having where we're actually pushing people to consider not working, to me, makes it very difficult to support this kind of transition. Now, bear in mind, Madam Speaker, that we also need to have the discussion that it is ultimately provinces as well that have a big role to play, as under our Constitution, they're the ones that are usually responsible for the social welfare of their population. And so, Madam Speaker, suddenly having a new federal program coming down, how it interacts with each individual province and their system of transfers, their systems of grants, their system of programs and services, I don't think will work. Madam Speaker, if we look to C-22 that was passed it was passed by this chamber, it talks about creating a Canada disability benefit. I would hope that all of us can acknowledge the truth. That particular program, we have no idea of how much someone can get, except that now we know that the government won't give more than, $2,000 a year, Madam Speaker, or $200 a month. You know, this is the problem we have, Madam Speaker, is we have so many different programs at the federal and provincial level, and they already are so extensively costly. I just don't think, Madam Speaker, that this is a good use of time and energy. So, Madam Speaker, again, I appreciate the sentiment. I do believe that we need to be thinking about how we can help out our fellow Canadian. Again, this is a country where we look after our own, but again, given my worries about the economic arguments, Madam Speaker, our aging demographics, the lack of clarity of what provincial programs are doing, the fact that provinces like BC have looked at this and have actually said, no, we're not proceeding with our own system, similar to what the member here entails. And then lastly, Madam Speaker, again, that reverse utilitarianism. We should not be considering more universal benefits, in my opinion, without first asking ourselves, what does this do to those that are suffering the most? I do believe that targeted programs, such as our guaranteed income supplement, should be looked at, Madam Speaker, and we should always be trying to ask ourselves, how can we help those that are in the most extreme of need, that are that do not have the revenues to be able to look after themselves, or those people that unfortunately, due to some circumstance, are with a disability that does not allow them to engage in Canadian society like the rest of us. So, Madam Speaker, I will be voting against this. I appreciate that there's a number of people that speak very, very strongly in this. But, Madam Speaker, if it comes down to it, I only have two choices in this, to support or not support. And I reluctantly will just say I am not going to be in support of, Madam Speaker, of a whole comprehensive change to our support programs for the reasons that I've given. Thank you very much for the time tonight, Madam Speaker, and thank you for people listening.
Resuming debate, the honourable member for North Island Powell River has 5 minutes to speak on this.
Well, thank you so much, Madam Speaker, and I'm really proud to have these 5 minutes to speak on this important piece of legislation. I first of all want to start out by thanking the member from Winnipeg Centre for doing the tremendous amount of work that she has done around this issue of having a real universal basic income for people. This piece of legislation is very simple in the state that it really says it's about creating a wide framework to look at a lot of the issues that the Conservatives have expressed some concerns about. How do we do this? What is the best way to do this? And would it be the most effective? When we look at the state of our society right now, we just see an increase of poverty. And we see it in the numbers. We know that the people that are everyday people working hard are making pretty stagnant income. The level of their income is staying at the place that it's been for a very long time. At the same time, the wealthiest people in this country and in many other countries are seeing a huge increase. So when we look at our system, it's becoming essentially unfair. And that's why we need to start looking at innovative programs like this, because it really says that we need a bar of dignity in our country that nobody should fall below. And I am not unlike every other Canadian who goes out in their community and lives in their community. And what we're seeing is more and more people struggling. We're seeing more and more people living on the streets. You know, I always say to people, it's easy to judge people who are living on the streets. I know who I am, but if you put me out on the streets with nothing, I have no idea who I would become. And that's what's happening in this country, is we're seeing people become disposable. But there are no disposable people, and it's wrong that we're there. So something like a guaranteed livable income would really talk about making sure people have the resources that they need. And Madam Speaker, I don't know if this place is being as thoughtful on this as they might be. Today we had a person, a veteran, come and speak to us. And one of the things that he talked about is how the system in Veterans Affairs under the Conservative and the Liberal government has increasingly become more frustrating. So if you come home as a veteran and you have trauma, you have illness, you have some sort of suffering, your partner now has to go out and fight for that money because it's a separate part of the bucket of money that goes to veterans. I don't know how many loved ones we've seen come to us and talk about the fact that they don't have enough time to work as much as they would like to because they're caring for their loved one. And so when we keep making these little buckets that people have to go and find out, know if they're available, know if they're allowed to, it makes the system fail for so many people. So we see them falling through the cracks. And by the time they've fallen through the cracks, the need is so high that addressing that need becomes overwhelming. You know, we've seen this work done in different places. I think of the the one place in Ontario where the Liberal government did it not too long ago. What they saw was mental health outcomes got better. People got to work. Oh my gosh, if you're not just trying to survive and you have absolutely nothing, it's really hard to dress nice enough to go get an interview. It's really hard to find the time if you have nobody to watch your kids to get out there and do those things. When people have a stable income, it doesn't make them not work. I'm tired of listening to Conservatives say that. It's not true. People thrive in opportunity, but it's hard to thrive when you don't know how you're going to survive the next day. And I think of people in my riding, you know, I'm going to be talking about this again and again. Right now we have seniors, another guaranteed livable system in our system, which is the guaranteed income supplement. Poorest seniors in Canada, their CPP got raised And this government didn't think about it for a minute. So what happened the next year? Their GIS got cut substantively. And now they're trying to make it through the month. They lost money because nobody plans. That's why we need a holistic program that serves everyone.
The honourable member for Winnipeg Centre has 5 minutes for right of reply.
Thank you so much, Madam Speaker. And I'd like to start out by thanking so many people, specifically Basic Income Canada, Manitoba, UBI Works, and of course, the Honourable Senator Kim Pate, who I partnered on the bill with her presenting it on the Senate side, because it's time for a guaranteed livable basic income that can bring people across Canada, to bring people across Canada that are falling through the cracks together. And I want to urge my colleagues to take this opportunity, a final effort, to get this passed to committee. Because I've heard today, oh, it's just a framework. Well, there are limits in PMBs. There's no budgetary allotment in it. You're not allowed to do that within the parameters of a PMB. But you are allowed to put in a framework. You are allowed to put in a framework that we can, of course, all together get to committee for further study. And I know that many people, all MPs across this parliament, heard from their constituents over the summer that people everywhere are struggling to keep up with the rising costs of living. The people that we represent need real solutions. And we have income guarantees in this country. EI, income guarantee, not livable. GIS, income guarantee, not livable. All I'm proposing, I'm not proposing anything new. All I'm proposing is to make current income guarantees livable and expand them out to, for people that are falling through the cracks. Somebody said it's not for international students. My bill very clearly states for anybody over the age of 17 residing in Canada. Everybody over the age of 17. But we know that in recent years, policymakers largely abandoned efforts to invest in our people and our communities, focusing instead on investing in huge corporations through subsidies and tax breaks. So to those who say that if we have a basic income, people will stop working, that's false. Research time and time again has proved that's false. There is no evidence that a basic income discourages work. It does, in fact, the exact opposite. For example, the Canadian Child Tax Benefit, for example, which is a kind of basic income in this country for families, mothers didn't work less, they actually worked more. The Canada Child Benefit grows the economy, if we want to talk about benefits to the economy, $2 for every dollar invested, and it keeps 250,000 families out of poverty and contributes 450,000 jobs to the economy. Basic income is good for the economy. And the myth of the poor person who's trying to game the welfare system is nothing more than poor bashing. Yep. What's far, far more common, Madam Speaker, is the ultra-wealthy gaming the system to evade paying taxes.
That's right.
So to those who say that if we have a basic income, inflation will get worse, that's false. Inflation worsens when the government borrows money or increases the money supply. But this is not necessary to introduce a JLBI. Every cent needed to support a basic income is already being spent in this economy on corporate subsidies and inefficiencies in the social safety net. And to those who say that a basic income is too expensive, I say, why don't we start talking about the high cost of poverty, like the fact that it costs $225,000 a year to house one woman in a federal penitentiary, or the high cost to our healthcare system. Poverty keeps people sick, causes strain to our healthcare system. That costs a lot of money. Governments dump billions to criminalizing poverty rather than addressing its root causes. So what I'm asking all members of Parliament to do today, let's study this more. I am asking for you to lend your voice, vote to get this to committee. Instead of basing decisions on false understandings of a JLBI, let's really study it. Let's at least support this bill to get it through second reading so that we can actually study it, so that we can make policy decisions based on facts
and not assumptions. So with that, I will end. Thank you, everybody who's supporting the bill. It means a lot to hundreds of thousands of people, including the many seniors who support this bill. And of course, the disability community who are critically left out of the social safety net. Thank you, Madam Speaker. Comme il est à 18h42.